see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry.
Overwhelmed, maybe feeling like you're all alone, not sure really what you're going to do next, and you don't know who to reach out to. Here today with fabulous guests, and what I want to share with you is that you're really not alone. People that I have on today have conquered so many incredible things. Okay, mic isn't on. They said it was. Do I start? Keep going?
Mm-hmm.
I think they froze it. They froze it. You got it. Thank you. Tom. Have you ever felt like you're all alone? You're trying to overcome some kind of adversity, and you feel like there's nobody there to really get you, to help you? The show today is incredible because we have people who are going to help you. You are not alone. What I want you to understand is that there are people ready to help. Reach out, and what I'm going to ask of you is that you take that helping hand, and then you go ahead and pay it forward by giving it to somebody else. Today we have an addiction counselor who's overcome adversity with drugs, alcohol, and went on to succeed, not only as an addiction counselor, but as a beautiful human being. And he's here today to share his story. We also have a woman who's going to show us how to conquer hunger on Long Island and how to bring the community together. And my third guest is an incredible survivor of prostate cancer. And he's also an event organizer and is going to share with us how he raises money for this cause. So when we come back, I'm really excited for you to meet these people and find and see what they can do to help you and those whom you love. We'll be right back.
Hey, I'm Tom Mealy from the Harrison Law Group. You know, soft tissue injury, that's no joke. This is what we do. We're not new at this game. Don't waste valuable time going to firms who don't get it and can't do it. Call 1-800-INJURY-LAW.
Huntington Toyota, the experience of a lifetime. Don't take our word for it.
The experience for me at Huntington Toyota made me feel very comfortable.
It's their professionalism, their honesty, and their integrity. I've bought at least 9 or 10 cars here at Huntington Toyota. They give me the best price around.
It never was about high pressure. It never was about them. It was always about us.
Today's cars are very similar, but Huntington Toyota is very different.
Huntington Toyota, where it's all about you.
Are you planning an event and want to include entertainment, but you're not sure where to turn?
Act1Entertainment.net has provided over 1,500 events with quality, affordable live entertainment at private parties, corporate affairs, festivals, bike rallies, and more. Act One will fit into your budget. They're friendly, reliable, and do all the legwork for you. They take all major credit cards. Log on to Act1Entertainment.net for a free, no-obligation price quote or call 631-758-3505 for a brochure.
You'll be happy you did.
All right, guys. You know this is a live show. I didn't realize you saw the beautiful Vicki Maley here. So I have to tell you, remember that it is live. But you know what? It doesn't take away from the fact that we have fantastic guests today. And my guest sitting right here is Keith Richard Godwin. Now, I met you when I was at a book signing, Doreen Gumer's book. Do you recall that?
Oh, yes, yes. It was real exciting. Doreen is an amazing woman doing amazing things. And just, you know, we met there, but it was an exciting event.
And the book was called If I Knew Now What I Knew Then. And I don't want you to tell me what the advice is, but I do at the end of the program. But I have to tell you, what I was very touched by was your honesty, your sense of humor, and your willingness to share all that's happened to you. And that's why I had you on today, because there may be somebody sitting there and they may know somebody who's in a similar situation. So what I want to do with you is right now go back to your childhood.
Sure.
Okay.
I wasn't as big back then.
No, you were. You're kind of a big guy. And we know that you use comedy to diffuse quite a bit, but I do believe that we are a product of our childhood. And your parents divorced, and you were rather young. Is that correct?
Yeah, my biological father, he also had an addiction problem, and he ended up in jail. I never really did met him, and he did pass. But then my mom did divorce, and then I had a stepdad who stepped in.
Well, Keith, let me ask this: do you think that addiction is hereditary? Then
there's definitely a piece that is. People who have some kind of genetic disposition have a greater chance
towards it.
Exactly.
Both alcoholism and drug addiction.
Correct. Yes.
Now, your name is interesting. You are very close to your mother.
Yeah,
and your sister. How did you get your name Keith Richard? What's that all about?
Well, my father's name was Benjamin Franklin III.
Okay.
Right. So they wanted me to be named Benjamin Franklin IV.
Right.
To carry it on, but my dad, you know, he had some sympathy on me. He's like, I don't want him to be teased as a kid. Ben, go fly a kite. And so he told my mom, name him whatever you want to name him. So my mother had a crush on Keith Richards from the Rolling Stones, so she named me Keith Richard. That's how I got my name. True story.
Now, your mom had remarried.
Correct.
How old were you when she remarried?
I probably was about 9 or something, maybe 7, 9. I don't remember the exact age.
The reason I'm bringing all this up is that it was not a good relationship.
Correct.
And you were tremendously affected by this.
Yeah, I look back now because I work in the addiction field, Gail, and everyone has their struggles. And mine at that time, my stepfather, for whatever issues he had, he brought into the thing. I was, you know, physically abused at times. And no matter what I did, it wasn't good enough. I mean, I would soccer. I was an all-star. I scored 7 goals and we lose 8-7. He's like, we should have scored 2 more.
Right.
And then I carried that with me, being an adult. Like, no matter what I do, I'm not good enough.
It's not good enough.
It's not...
which is an interesting lesson, you know,
right.
When we have children, that we have to make sure that that's understood because we don't realize what we're doing. But do you recall the thoughts that you had as a child?
I remember being afraid.
Afraid.
You know, I was always afraid that I was going to do something wrong or, you know, or be embarrassed. So, you know, I kind of held that in. You know, I acted out in different ways as a kid. I was always in trouble as a kid. I was a good kid deep down, but I was always like, you know, I took on the role as like, you know, the mascot or the, you know, cracking jokes to try to defer a lot of the attention. I got involved with, you know, a lot of other kids who had some kind of dysfunction going on, and we kind of came together. We weren't bad kids. We were just getting into a lot of mischief.
Getting into a lot of mischief.
Yeah.
And humor was always a part of your life. And, you know, you can tell me if I'm right or wrong, because you are a comic.
Correct.
Do you find a lot of comedians cover up a lot of the sad aspects of their life by using humor to diffuse it?
I wouldn't use the word cover up. Okay. I would say they use it to heal themselves, not to cover it up. But it's a piece of them. And then once they come to terms with it, it's so real to them that they can bring it out in a comical way. Because a lot of the ways we feel growing up, or whether we were picked on, everyone was picked on in a way, and we have these things. And when comics bring it out, it's like the little things in our head that we're feeling, but a comic's bringing it out, and that's what makes it funny. Like, I can identify with that. That's, you know, how, you know, we all have that little child in us that was...
Oh, sure. And many of us, hopefully, do not lose that little child in us.
Exactly.
No problem with that. So when you were in school, you acted out somewhat, right?
Correct, yeah.
When did you turn to drugs? And many people do this to cover up a lot of the pain that they're feeling.
Right. When I was younger, I was really good at sports. And then once I got away from sports and started drinking, it must have been about maybe 10th grade, 11, mm-hmm. when I first got, early high school. And towards the end of high school, I was, you know, that was more important to me than anything else.
Well, let me ask you this too. Now, you're in high school, and as a former high school and college teacher, mm-hmm. 42 minutes a day, 155 students a day, not always sure what we're supposed to be looking for. So what should a teacher look for in a student? Because didn't anybody help you in high school? Did anybody see it?
Well, the thing I should have looked for is me in the class, because I wasn't there most of the time.
So you were cutting
classes? I was always cutting class, and I was, you know, that was the main thing. Yeah, I used to cut class a lot, and, you know, sometimes I didn't even go to school. And then when I was there, I would sometimes be sleeping, you know, come in late, have to use the bathrooms all the time.
So you didn't have mandatory attendance as we do now, where you have to be in school, you have to be present certain number of days.
Correct, because if you can keep accountability of someone, it will show up.
Absolutely.
And actually, in my senior year in high school, they came out with that rule.
Okay.
And they you needed 24 absences to graduate. I had 24 before the first quarter was over.
Oh,
so I couldn't graduate. I had to move in with my grandmother in another school in Massapequa that didn't have the same law to graduate high school.
To graduate.
So they did come out with it in my senior year, and mm-hmm. I guess it was kind of because of that. But if people are usually showing up regularly, you can get a better scale on them,
who
they are. Right?
Definitely. Well, let me ask you, again, as a teacher, what should somebody look for, either as a teacher, an educator, or perhaps as a parent, and maybe not knowing that the child is using? Because many people can cover this up, correct?
Correct. And if you know someone, what I do as an addiction therapist, mm-hmm. I look for patterns. And because everyone's not the same. If someone's quiet, that doesn't mean, you know, there's something. If someone's talking, it doesn't mean there's something wrong. But if someone's usually a certain way, if they come home and they come see you right away, and that now they're coming home, they go right to their room.
Sure.
Or that, you know, you look
something
for...
Something that's different.
Something that's different, right.
And you're right, because we're talking about high school, where the hormones are askew. We're talking about moodiness at different times.
Right.
Learning about yourself. So that's why it may be a little bit more difficult to see it unless you have that definite pattern. So you went to live with your grandmother, you said.
Right. My grandmother, God bless her soul, she's mm-hmm. She passed within the last year.
Did.
Yeah, but she lived a full life, 92. She even said, I want to pass in my sleeping. And when everything she said came to true. So God bless her. But she was, I was like her oldest grandson, firstborn grandson.
Oh, I know. I remember what she said, the advice. We're going to share that. Now, you graduated from school.
Correct. I did get my high school diploma.
Right. And then you went into the service from 1986 to 1990. The Marines.
Hoorah.
You got to tell me about that, because it's interesting that you were in trouble for acting out, and it's almost as if you were looking for some kind of discipline. Was that the case, or why did you end up in the Marines?
Well, it's a couple of stories. I don't like people telling me what I can't do. And when I was a kid, even I ran the Long Island Marathon 4 times, and I didn't train. People are like, you can't do it unless you train. I go, I can do whatever. And I ran it 4 years in a row. And when I says I want to join the Marines, people are like, you'll never make it in the Marines.
Right.
So that made me wanted to go even more.
Mm-hmm.
And when I got in, you know, it was a shock. It wasn't like the...
Well, that's what I was wondering, because there you're getting that discipline. Now, in the Marines, from what I understand, you had some difficulty. You got into fights. You had blackouts. I think you were even arrested from time to time. Again, did anybody pick up you knew at this point you were having some troubles.
Right.
So,
You know what's funny? You think of Marines, crazy, wild.
Right.
You know, how are you going to pick out someone? I got picked out of all Marines saying, you know, you have a problem. And they did tell me I needed some help.
They did.
They did. And I wasn't ready to accept it at that time. And You know, I was like, that's what Marines do. We go out, we drink, we get into fights, we cause havoc.
This is what your expectation is.
This is what, yeah.
Here's an interesting quote that you said, and I quote, because my fun times were centered around substance abuse, it seemed to me that I was having a great time. Is this denial?
It's all I knew. And when I was outside myself, I did have some good times.
Mm-hmm.
But then it was fun until it wasn't. And then it was never the same again. Because when I was younger, it might have just been me being a little crazy as a young kid. But
I
never got out of that mode. And I did work. I worked with the developmentally disabled for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And I was able to hold it together somewhat. I mean, I still drank too much, partied on the weekends. But I had some kind of structure. And when I lost my arm, and I wasn't working. I wasn't working. That's when my disease took another life with free time.
Before we get to that, you do get an honorable discharge.
I do, yes.
And you're extremely proud of
exactly.
You should rightfully be so
right.
In the Marines. Now you are out of the Marines. Did you work as a security security?
I did actually. Like you said, I did get an honorable discharge in the Marines, which was one of I some great experiences there, some great lessons, and some great people who did reach out to me. So it kind of planted the seed.
Stayed with you.
Yeah, and when I did change, I realized the people who were there for me, who I wasn't ready to hear. And what was the next?
Well, I wanted to ask you too. You were stabbed
right.
Under the heart. You're an imposing size. What are you, 6'6"?
Right.
Big guy? I think if it weren't for that, you might not have even made it, if it's possible.
Right. I say that. I got stabbed below the heart.
If you weren't. And that had to do with a bad drug?
Yeah, I was.
You mentioned
the security. I did work.
Yeah.
I worked in a 5-star hotel in Manhattan. I met Tom Selleck, Tom Cruise.
I met all
these celebrities. Yeah,
really?
Nicole Kidman, Bill Murray. Bobby Short used to play in the Cafe Carlisle.
Right,
I used to work in the Carlisle Hotel. Eartha Kitt, Dixie.
And you have
Carter.
A problem during this time.
Yeah, I worked the 4 to 12. So I was really good during my shift. I can be on point. And I was always good at what I did, whether I was in the Marines or when I was working. It came after work was over when the craziness began with me. So it didn't look like I had a problem because at work I was there.
You were able to cover it up. You were able to still function. And
right.
Still party.
I got off at 12. I partied till 7 in the morning. I slept for a few hours and went back to work at 4. Mm-hmm. You know, so I was able to kind of mask it. But I didn't realize how different my life could be without the use of drugs and alcohol. Or
because this is what you were accustomed to. And this is what you're
for
expecting.
So long.
And maybe the more fun you thought you were having, more escapism as well. You're probably involved even further in the drugs.
Yeah, it took.
It's a cycle.
It took me in a cycle, and when things didn't go right, that's all I knew how to turn to.
Let me also ask you then. You said that you had gotten stabbed, so you had that, and then the accident? Is that what happened?
No, I actually had my accident before. I was in a car accident. I hit a construction site, and I lost my arm.
And you were intoxicated
at the time? Yes, I was drinking at the time.
It's important for to get that out.
And you know what? And I wrapped it in a way where I didn't feel like it was my fault because I was working as a manager in a sales company. I was taking this guy to see his girlfriend in the hospital. So I was doing good things.
Right.
But while I was waiting for him, I was like, I might as well have a six pack.
Drinks.
Yeah, and then he took me home. I'm taking him home. He's like, yo, thanks for taking me. Can I, buy you dinner, a few more drinks? And then I dropped him off at home. And then on my way to my girlfriend's at the time is when I had the accident.
As I recall, you said you were burning.
Yeah, I was unconscious. Thank God, I was in a trapped car that was burning, and they couldn't get me out. And they used the fire department saved my life. They used the jaws of life to pull me out, but my whole arm burnt already, and my leg was broke, and there was all kinds of stuff wrong with me. So
still not ready to stop at this point. Is that correct?
Correct.
However, you have somebody very special. You're 6'6". A 5'1" lady, probably weighed 100 and something pounds,
right.
Called Grandma.
Yeah.
And Grandma turns to you, very upset with you. You are my firstborn.
Mm-hmm.
You were in the Marines.
Right.
And now you are a drunkard.
Right.
What happened to you when she said that?
You know what? It's and there's a combination of what I needed was tough love and unconditional love. And my mother always gave me...
I love that.
My mother always gave me that tough love, but she gave me the unconditional love. But when I pushed that limit, she would call me, which I needed to be. My grandmother was there for me regardless, and her door was open, but she didn't know the in-depth that my mom did. So if she would have known some of the stuff my mom did, she might have took a different stance, but she always opened her door to me, and I was living in a senior center towards the end, in her room.
Really?
Yeah, with my grandmother, and then she did look at me one day, and she's like, you know, I came in drunk, you know, or high, or both, and she's like, she's like, what happened to you? You know, like you just said, and I just felt like this big, and I said, you know what, I'm going to get some help. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I meant it, but I didn't realize it was going to be a lifelong thing. But once I got that help, I never went back to using again, and it's been about 9.5 years.
Yeah, it was actually, what, April 20th, 2004, that she
correct,
turned
exactly,
and she
yeah.
looked at you and she said that. So you were ready. So how do we help somebody who's in that situation that isn't quite ready? What do you say to somebody?
I mean, and even though I was ready, I did have a slip-up because I was ready, but I had no help. It was just my willpower. And okay. A lot of things I did on my life on willpower, this was one thing I could not do. I needed the help of others.
You needed the help of someone else.
Yeah, and so I said, I'm going to go into a program, and I had 2 weeks to wait to get in. So I 11 days I stayed in my grandmother's house without doing anything. I didn't leave, but then I got the itch. I went out one last time, which was April 20th, 2004. And I went out, I went to a Met game, I got, you know, and then I went into a program to get help. Can I say the program or?
Sure, you went in for 28 days.
Yeah, it was CK Post, and I still
CK Post.
I still do comedy there. I do it once a month since I graduated, because that's where I started to do comedy, because I was a counselor before, but I never got involved in my, I was miserable being not drinking, not drugging. I didn't know how to come out of my shell. I didn't deal with a lot of my issues.
Your body's probably feeling everything psychologically, physically.
Yeah, I didn't deal with a lot of the stuff I needed to deal with the first time. This time, I got through some core issues, got around some core people, and not to advocate a particular 12-step program, but I got involved in one, and that's helped save my life, you know?
Yeah, you have to be ready for it, and I think that's one of the biggest messages that you have there. All right, so you are now working as an addiction counselor.
Yeah.
And you work over at the Northport Veterans Center.
Right.
And you're also going to places where people are incarcerated and helping them as well.
Yeah, well, I work for the Northport VA as a counselor, and they gave me the help I needed to, like, the next step after CK Post. I started as a patient getting help there. They helped me. They educated me. I was on disability. I didn't think I would ever work again. So they,
really?
Yeah, and they did all this, and I was willing to take the help, which was hard, and that was the first step.
That's so interesting. Remember what I said before, like, you know, somebody has to put the hand out there, and you have to be ready to take that help and then do what you're doing, which is to share this with other people and to pay it forward, and that's how we're all connected.
Yeah, and I couldn't have a better job. I also work at Talbot House Catholic Charities. It's a crisis center where people come in raw, and I actually started working there because I was doing comedy for them as a volunteer.
Right.
So just to cheer them up, saying, see, you can laugh when you're not using, and you can enjoy yourself, because that's what I never knew. And then I did that for like a year and a half, and they're like, can you work here part-time? So I also work there per diem now. So.
I think you also learned to laugh at yourself.
Oh, yeah.
I think you also got more confident with who you were and who you are as a person. I mean, that's what it sounds like.
And it took time. We were talking earlier, and I mean, I lost my arm, and for a while, it was devastating. I didn't want to talk to no one. I'd look in the mirror. I would be crying, you know. And
I wanted to ask you about that. How did laughter empower you to overcome your disabilities?
It's not going to hurt me. What's happened, happened.
Happened. Okay.
You know, I don't minimize what happened.
No.
But I'm not going to let it continue to hurt me for the rest of my life. This is the hand I got. Mm-hmm. And I'm blessed to be alive. It could be so much worse. I lost a hand, so I'm comfortable with it now. It took me a while to get comfortable. I use it in my act. I was like, oh, people, like, how do you use your hand? I was like, I was at an alligator petting zoo.
Right.
I use, you like, different. And once I do that, like, you just, like, gasp.
I laugh.
People get comfortable around you. They're not like, oh, you are right. You know, I'm so sorry. And, you know, I don't want to be treated with pity.
Well, you know I'm nearsighted.
Right.
We all know that. However, when I heard you speak and when I spoke to you, I didn't even notice because you're so imposing a person. Your personality takes over. So it's not something I'm looking at or looking for. So you have to know that. And that's because you are so comfortable with yourself. Let's talk about Comedy to Go. I love this. We've heard of you know, fast food restaurants.
Right, right.
This is fast food comedy. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about that, please.
Actually, I met a friend when I went on my journey to comedy. We met in comedy school together, mm-hmm. and we decided we wanted to get on stage more. We started a business, and he's a good Christian guy, and we had a lot in common. And we're like, we started to do little shows, and then it just grew. And we helped someone raise money. There was a gentleman who was passing away, a correction officer, and we helped him raise money, you know, for his family before he went, for whatever reason, the insurance wasn't right. And it's like, isn't this great, helping people raise money? And the guy said he did pass, like, that's the last day of his life, his wife said, that he actually laughed and enjoyed himself. And we all are going to go one day, but what do we do with the time we have, the quality of life we have? And laughter is just an amazing thing. And when you tie it to a cause, everyone is coming anyway to see a show to enjoy themselves. And when you can do something financially beneficial for an agency, and we made a lot of connections through...
Icing on the cake, right?
Right, exactly.
So. And you know what? Of course, you're releasing your endorphins. You have less pain. You're united in laughter. We're all together and on it. So I think that's also part of it as well.
Yeah, there's a whole medical thing, and you just touched on some of them, but it helps with pain. It's, you know, your body's natural feel-good chemicals.
Absolutely. And if you ever want to just, well, when we met today, we were laughing.
Yeah.
And we started to have a bond, and you said, I like this. I'm really comfortable here. This is a good place. I didn't know what to expect.
Right, right.
And because of that, you know, we want you to succeed. We want you to do better. So we're all united, and we're all in it together. What about recovery?
Well, what happened is Comedy to Go is great, but my passion, it's helping everyone as much as you can, but we all have to pick our choices where we want to devote most of our time.
Exactly.
And me being a person who was in recovery and didn't get it because I couldn't learn to enjoy and laugh, I started to focus my comedy on people in detoxes, rehabs, and recovery and just volunteer and do the comedy, and then I would see the benefits. And I ran into a lot of comics who also do the... who are in recovery, because comedy is a tough life. So a lot of them either had some type of addiction or they have life issues, and they, like you mentioned earlier, and they talk about it in their comedy. And to hear people talking about stuff like, you know, when they were younger or whatever, and making it in a comedy thing, like we're all, you know, people are laughing and identifying, and I just found out it's just such a great experience for them, for me, and it changes the whole atmosphere of the programs we do it at.
And in fact, going back to your Comedy to Go, you have so many different types of humor.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, your humor for Phoenix House was a little bit different than it is for a corporation.
Correct.
And you really look at all of the ages of the people, but you do everything. You do the flyers, you set everything up, and just come right in and deliver a fantastic show. I started the show by saying that I'd like to know what it is that you know today that you wish you knew then. Do you remember?
Yeah, you did. And that's a tough question because I think everything I know today is as a result of things that have happened to me in the past. I just wish I could have recognized that this was actually a problem back then. But I couldn't. I wasn't able to hear all these other people. It's like, you know, if seven people say it's a duck, it's usually a duck. But I'm the one who's saying, it's a pig.
It's not.
I wish I wouldn't have been as thick-headed and got this a little bit sooner. And I might have not had to not only go through my own struggles, put my loved ones and family members through the struggle of my addiction. So chances are if you're told enough and, you know, there's a good chance that you don't have to go any, you don't have to go any lower. You don't have to.
How about this? See if this sounds familiar. Smart people learn from their own mistakes.
Right.
Wise people learn from the mistakes of others.
Yep, that's in my book. That's a true statement to this day.
Well, we have a big treat right now. We're going to come back from a commercial, and Keith Godwin is going to entertain us with clean humor and give us some of the reasons why he has become so popular. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
For professional motorcycle transport and towing, think Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing. Proudly serving all of Long Island, we feature expert handling and 24/7 service. So send a limo for your toy with Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing.
Old Spice Body Spray will make you feel so powerful it'll blow your mind right in front of your face.
Goodbye.
Oh no! My kid, I don't.
power.
Automatic freshness, softness, and static control has never been easier with the Bounce Dryer Bar. I just stick it to the inside of my dryer, and I never have to remember.
Oh, Old Spice Body Spray makes you smell like power! It's so powerful, it sells itself in other people's commercials. You smell like outdoor freshness.
You smell like power.
Yeah, I do. Power! Power!
When your cable's on the fritz, you get frustrated. When you get frustrated, your daughter imitates. When your daughter imitates, she gets thrown out of school. When she gets thrown out of school, she meets undesirables. When she meets undesirables, she ties the knot with undesirables. And when she ties the knot with undesirables, you get a grandson with a dog collar. Don't have a grandson with a dog collar. Get rid of cable and upgrade to DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
Like so many people, are your finances tight lately? Afraid to open your mail or even answer your phone? Well, take heart. You don't have to live like that. If you're 62 or older and own your own home, you can join the thousands of folks who have used safe and effective government-insured reverse mortgages. The government-insured reverse mortgages from Long Island's Senior Reverse Network allow you to stay in your home and turn equity into tax-free cash. Our government-insured reverse mortgages can eliminate mortgage payments, credit card balances, or just improve your lifestyle. Do yourself a favor and solve these problems now. Call the Senior Reverse Network, and our advisors will answer all of your questions about our reverse mortgage programs. We've helped scores of senior Long Island homeowners like you who now enjoy a worry-free retirement. Get the financial security and peace of mind you've dreamed about. Pick up the phone and call us at the Senior Reverse Network now to set up a free consultation.
Call 1-800-985-REVERSE. That's 1-800-985-7383.
Welcome to Formula Auto Wash, where every day is a great day for a car wash. Open 7 days a week from 8 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. Sundays, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. Detailing packages for every budget, starting out at $29.99. 100% hand wash and detail center. Hogs hair and microfiber brushes and mitts. Proudly using Ecolab Blue Coral soaps and waxes. Formula Auto Wash has served the community for over 30 years. Senior discounts all day, every day. Ladies Day Wednesday, $3 off any wash. Early bird discount Monday through Thursday till 9:30 a.m. Check out our website, formulaautowash.com.
Hi, welcome back, and we have Just Plain Keith, as he would like to be known. So, Just Plain Keith, take it away.
All right, hello everyone. It's great to be here on the TV, Gail's TV show, and it was a little tough for me getting here. I got to be honest, I did get pulled over coming here. It's about honesty. I do teach that. I was doing 80 and a 55. The cop pulled me over. He happened to be a Marine, so I got a little bit lucky. He's like, I see you're a Marine. I'm a Marine. I'm having a hard time writing you a ticket. I was like, well, thank God for that, because I'd have a hard time paying it. So I actually did get here. I am all right, so it's good to be here and talk to everyone. I feel refreshed. I just got back from vacation. Me and my wife just went away. We went to Jamaica. You know, times are good. Next year we're saving up. We're hoping to make it all the way to Penn Station. So, but it's a one thing at a time, and we'll all be all right. What do I want to talk about? I just want to talk about coming here. It was just a little bit of a hassle for me. I jumped in the shower because I wanted to be squeaky clean when I got here, and my wife sees me getting out of the shower, drying off with the towel. My wife's like, what are you doing? I'm like, what does it look like I'm doing? I'm drying off with the towel. She's like, that towel? I'm like, what's wrong with that towel? She's like, that's the show towel. It ain't for drying. It's just for looking.
I know that.
I was like, but honey, you know, that's the only towel here. She says, just don't use it. So I actually said what I wanted to say. I says, okay, dear. And we just had to move on from here. But I don't know. We have show towels. In the bedroom, we have show pillows. There's 27 of them, different colors, different shapes, and they're all on the bed. It's like once we leave, she puts them all there so I cannot take a nap during the day. Naps are off limits for me because then the pillows get... Once in a while, I try to sneak in a nap, but she knows. She knows. She's like, the pillows are moved. Were you on the show pillows? I'm like, show pillows and show towels. And then worst of all, we have the show dishes. They sit in the kitchen. They're in a nice case. You know, they're just to look at. You can't drink out of them. You can't use them. You just look at them. It's like a big tease in my house. I don't know where to go. I don't know what to do. I can't lay on my bed. I can't use the dishes. I can't dry off with the towels. It's just, you know, one thing after another with that. But, you know, I don't want to sit here and seem like, you know, I don't love my wife because I love her to death. My wife's a great woman. We don't have any kids, but what I do have is I have a puppy. I have a little Shih Tzu poodle, you know. So she's really cute. Her name is Giggles. It kind of suits me good. And it's funny. We're training her now to go outside to go to the bathroom. We got one of those things. They're called little wee-wee pads. And they're really cute. You put them down. It's like the highlight of my day. You put them down. The dog goes on a little wee-wee pad. And you reinforce her positive behavior. You go, yay! You went wee-wee. You do like a little wee-wee dance. And my wife does better dancing than me. But you do the little wee-wee dance. And the dog's all happy. And, you know, it's really. And my wife's like, she gets upset with me about this now. She's like, well, you're paying more attention to the dog. And you're not paying enough attention to me. It's just like, I feel like I can't win. So every time my wife goes to the bathroom, I go, yay! Yay! You did pee-pee. Here's a treat. So, but it gets tough. And on vacation, it was really cool. And you know, I don't drink anymore, which is great. And people are like, oh, you don't drink. Why don't you drink? You have trouble drinking? It's like, I have no trouble drinking. Stopping was always my problem. Not the drinking. The drinking I was good with. So, yeah, just coming back here, one more thing. We went to get our car washed. And I went to one of these self-serve car washers. I don't know if anyone's been to them. But you soap, you scrub, you rinse, and you go. You put in like $7. You soap, you scrub, you rinse, you go. So I, you know, start soaping the car. I'm scrubbing the car. I go to rinse the car. And there's no water. I'm like, oh, my God. So I'm like, I have no more money. I'm like, so I start driving home. And people are like beeping their horns at me. They're flashing their lights at me. They're yelling at me, the sun's on your car! The sun's on your car! So I'm stuck at a light. There's this Italian guy. He's like, yo, the sun's on your car! So I roll down the window. I'm like, huh? He's like, the sun's on your car! I was like, do you have a towel? He's like, yeah. I was like, is it a show towel? He said he didn't know. I was like, I can't risk it. I'm in enough trouble already. You guys have been great. We're going to go to a commercial break right now. Thank you very much and stay tuned.
Like so many people, are your finances tight lately? Afraid to open your mail or even answer your phone? Well, take heart. You don't have to live like that. If you're 62 or older and own your own home, you can join the thousands of folks who have used safe and effective government-insured reverse mortgages. The government-insured reverse mortgages from Long Island's Senior Reverse Network allow you to stay in your home and turn equity into tax-free cash. Our government-insured reverse mortgages can eliminate mortgage payments, credit card balances, or just improve your lifestyle. Do yourself a favor and solve these problems now. Call the Senior Reverse Network, and our advisors will answer all of your questions about our reverse mortgage programs. We've helped scores of senior Long Island homeowners like you who now enjoy a worry-free retirement. Get the financial security and peace of mind you've dreamed about. Pick up the phone and call us at the Senior Reverse Network now to set up a free consultation.
Call 1-800-985-REVERSE. That's 1-800-985-7383.
Eva, one of our 4 million owners, has her cat insured with Folksam. This one is for you.
I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running.
Visit folksam.se and tell us what makes your heart beat faster.
Yosuke, 乗ってみるか。
うん。
おい待てよ、凌介。
どこ行くんだよ。
なんでじゃねえ。
親父。
出てけ。
お父さんいつものところよ。
うん。乗ってみる？
車だな。
ありがとう。
We're back with the lovely Tracy Lobdell. Welcome to the show, Tracy.
Thank you, Gail.
Fun so far.
I absolutely am. Yes, it's
terrific.
Been great.
Now, Tracy is the executive director of Construction Long Island Incorporated. And before we get to that, I just want to say that it's a pleasure having you here. You do so much for different, you know, for our community with different types of work. And before we get into construction, you were given a couple of awards in 2011 for construction, and then you were also given the award for Woman of Distinction in 2013. So congratulations.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Construction, the whole philosophy, what I understand, is to rid Long Island of people not having enough food to eat.
Exactly.
I was shocked at the statistics. Over 320,000 people on Long Island, not enough food. Over 120,000 children.
Children. Isn't that sad on Long Island?
Right.
Yes.
So where did this idea of canstruction come from?
Well, canstruction was originally the brainchild of a woman that worked for an architectural firm in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. And it actually started in 1992. She dreamed up the idea, produced the first event in New York City, and it just started to grow. And it is now an international organization.
Incredible.
There are over 140 cities around the world that produce canstruction events every year. And of course, we brought canstruction to Long Island in 2007. So this will now be our seventh event this year, and we're really looking forward to
it. Incredible. Now with canstruction, and we're going to show some pictures of some of the beautiful work you're doing. Mm-hmm. You have usually four or five. You have an architect, you have a builder, and the idea is to showcase that there is hunger on Long Island, what we're doing about it, bringing the community together, and then in a two-week exhibit, mm-hmm. correct?
Yes.
We show all of the thousands of cans that have been collected and then dispersed later on to homeless shelters, mm-hmm. to the Harry Chapin Foundation.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit more about that, please.
Well, we actually have teams that start designing their structures for the next event the day after we hold an event. So our events are always the fourth Thursday in October, and then our exhibit is open for 10 to 14 days, depending on the availability of our venue. And we have teams that as soon as they finish one event, they start planning what they're going to do for the next event.
So for months they're doing this?
Absolutely, 4 months, and they are designing and selecting cans. You know, the structure that they're building is 8 feet tall, and can be as wide as 10 feet and as deep as 10 feet. So they can use thousands upon thousands of cans.
And they have what's a build out for 12 hours where they actually
yes.
come in and create it. Now, are they actually building, and this year it's going to be the RXR in
RXR Plaza,
right?
Yes.
So do they bring all of the materials there?
We arranged to get that to them.
Oh,
we have
gosh.
Quite a few very okay. generous in-kind sponsors, and we have a moving company that
okay.
transports the cans from their practice build site, which is generally their office. Canstruction is a charity of the architectural, engineering, design, and construction industries. We also include high school and middle school students and college students on the teams. But these teams mm-hmm. begin by deciding what type of structure they'd like to build, designing that, and then going out and looking for the cans that will paint the picture oh. of that structure. And the labels, of course, are very important.
Right.
They will take, as I mentioned, perhaps as long sometimes as 12 months to mm-hmm. design their structures. They will practice building all or portions of them in their offices, and then a couple of days before the event, the moving company actually comes over, picks everything up, transports it over to RXR Plaza, which is the old EAB Plaza
right,
in Uniondale.
From the Coliseum.
Across from the Coliseum.
Okay,
yes.
excellent.
And then they have 12 hours to build the structure, and that's it. And we have had a few teams that have taken every last minute.
That's just amazing.
The structures are incredible. They're
Who are the jurors or judges for this?
Well, we invite different industry celebrities, if
okay.
you will. We try and get local individuals that that we think that the people that attend our reception would be interested
right.
in meeting. But we generally look to get an mm-hmm. architect, an engineer, a contractor, and
right.
then a local personality involved.
But look what you're doing. You're bringing not only awareness to poverty on Long Island, mm. but you're feeding people,
yes.
and you're bringing the community together.
Yes.
And you even have mentors for the children.
I
mean,
do.
Many times, I knew I wanted to be a high school English teacher. Mm. I didn't know high school. I thought it was elementary, till I went one day and said, high school. But I always knew I wanted to teach.
Mm-hmm.
So many of our young people don't know what they want to do. Look at the exposure that they're being given to get into that field and do it.
Well, that's exactly why we started to include
the
middle and high school students and, of course, the college students
right.
that are in degree programs for architecture, engineering, design, or construction. Gives them an opportunity to meet perhaps future employers.
Before we show the video, I also know that you have one of the exhibits where if people bring in cans, mm-hmm. they can bring as many cans as they want for the people's choice,
yes.
which is usually 3 days later when you make the announcement as to who has won. I love the symbol of it too, the three cans.
Mm-hmm.
One can to show that people can make a difference
mm-hmm.
with kindness.
Yes.
One can to show that they're building these structures.
Mm-hmm.
And another can, of course, to show the catalyst for change. Let's
exactly.
see that video, please, which shows a little bit how the concept comes together, what it looks like, and the finished product. And as we're setting it up, it will be October 25th through the 6th of November.
Yes.
And it's from 8 in the morning until 6 p.m.
Yes.
Correct?
That's correct.
And
again,
a can of admission.
Yes.
Okay. We're watching that video right now.
Construction is a yearly design build competition where teams of architects and engineers and students they mentor get together and they build these beautiful giant sculptures out of cans. And then all the cans are given to City Harvest to go out to the different food banks around the five boroughs of New York City.
We have been partnered with them for many years, and throughout the years we've collected over 1 million pounds of food.
It's a lot of fun. It's really fun during the planning stages when you're just brainstorming what could possibly be made out of cans. It's for a good cause as well, and a good group of people that do it every year. So it's a lot of fun.
This is our 9th year, actually. Yeah, so we've been doing it for a while. I personally have been doing it for 6. It takes a while. We start in about August. It's when we first start coming up with the idea and really putting in some time to brainstorm about how we're going to build it. We have to visit some stores to figure out which cans we can get, like which fit the color scheme and size that we want. And then we really just start like gathering the material slowly, and we do a practice build in the office to try to get an idea of how constructible it is.
And then they're juried for different prizes. We have best use of labels, we have best meal, best structure, and juror's favorite, and then they give two honorable mentions.
One we always shoot for is the structural integrity one, just because we're structural engineers, so we kind of pride ourselves on, you know, being able to tweak it a little bit, try to push the limits a little bit. So I think hopefully we did that.
So this year we're trying to go for best meal. It's sort of a Thanksgiving theme, a vegetarian theme. So we have things like carrots, beans, we have sweet potatoes, some soups, and so forth, all orange colored foods. I just hope they get inspired by, you know, the cool structural things that have been done, as well as just awareness of, you know, how many people are hungry out there, that these cans can actually do some good once they're deconstructed and provided to City Harvest.
That you do. You are also involved with 100 women who care about Long Island, which is also a 501c3 that was organized, I believe, this year and came from what, Michigan?
Michigan in 2006. It was originally founded in Michigan, and it actually is not a 501c3. The beauty of the organization is that it's not an organization. It's a group of women that get together for one-hour meetings once every quarter and pledge to donate $100 to a charity that the group all agrees to donate to. And when that group is selected, every member writes out their $100 check directly to the charity. So there are no administrative costs. There's no money spent on anything but the needs of the charity. It's
and
wonderful.
I love that, because you could raise as much as $10,000 in one hour. Sitting. And if there's a tie, you draw the name out of the hat. Mm-hmm. The only thing is that the person who wins has to come back and cannot solicit funds and must also say how everything's being used.
Exactly. We
Thank
do ask
you,
them for
Tracy,
accountability.
I love all that information.
Thank you, Gail.
And I do have to introduce the person who's sitting next to you, who's been so patient in the green room, because he has quite a story to tell, too. This gentleman overcame prostate cancer, and his name is Sandy Kane. Welcome to the show, Sandy.
Thank you, Gail. Thank you for having me.
Oh, thank you. Sandy, I do want to ask you a couple of questions. I think from what I've read, the most significant message that I received from you is early diagnosis. Would you agree?
Early testing.
Early testing of the PSA, the protein that is in?
Yes. The PSA is nothing more than a blood test. A lot of guys get paranoid about it because, you know, they have to drop their pants. Nothing whatsoever. It's a simple blood test, the same as you go to the doctor when they draw blood for everything else, when you take
everything.
A quarterly physical. They just put another vial in, they draw the blood, and 2 weeks later, hopefully you get the right answer rather than the wrong answer.
I was astounded to find that it's 36 times more prevalent than women getting breast cancer. Every 2 minutes, a man is being diagnosed.
Yeah.
One out of every six men will have this disease. The good news is that it's not the kind of disease that would attach or fix itself to a particular organ, so that if it's caught early enough, it can be cured.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Every man has prostate cancer in him. The question is if you're going to die from it or with it. If you get it diagnosed early enough, there are a number of different procedures. There are surgical procedures. There are radiation procedures that can be applied, and they're about 90-95% effective if it's caught early enough.
Right.
If the cancer has started to metastasize, which means that it's spread from the outside, then it's a whole different story, but we don't talk about that at all.
No, because, and you said there are other treatments as well. You have chemo, you have radiation, you have surgery, you have watch and wait, which doesn't sound like you're an advocate, or that's up to the doctor, depending upon the case, correct?
You know, I got to tell you, every guy I talk to when they talk about watch and wait,
right.
If they've been through it, they don't want to know from it. But watch and wait usually applies to men who are over 70.
Correct.
And over 70, and if it's a very slow-growing prostate, a slow-growing cancer, which they can tell. They do a biopsy, and they come up with a scale. It's called the Gleason score, and they can tell the level of activity of the cancer, whether it's a progressive cancer or it's a very slow-growing.
Now, you don't fear if you have this test and it comes out higher than a 4. We know that many times you have a biopsy if it is over a 4, and that would be the number. But there are people who have had 7, 8, and
15,
okay.
20, 15. 30, 40.
So you don't panic. It's the fear of the unknown that would make people nervous. Tell us about your group that's going to meet. Let's see, is it September 8th?
So Sunday, September 8th.
Right.
And at the Sears Auto Center across from Broadway Mall in Hicksville. The whole premise behind this, you as a woman, and you especially know, will go for a mammogram.
Correct.
Guys will not go to get tested. They're afraid of two things. They're afraid of impotence, and they're afraid of incontinence. If we can get them closer to a doctor's office or a pseudo-doctor's office, we stand a better chance of coercing them. And I think that's the only word you can use to get them in to get tested. What do guys like? Guys like cars. So the premise behind this is cruising, Long Island Cruising for a Cure is a car show. At the car show, we have a lab set up. We're using Winthrop University Hospital at Mineola this year. They bring down a number of phlebotomists. They bring some nurses. Mm-hmm. They bring some secretarial help to do all the HIPAA-required recording. And while they're there, we coerce them, as I said. We coerce them to get them in and take a test. All it is a simple blood test.
That's all it is.
We're in our eighth year. We've done 1,600 tests. We've caught 54 potential cases of prostate cancer.
And the money, last year $20,000, went for the testing and also money to go to Cold Spring Harbor so that you could do research.
We donated $20,000 to Cold Spring Harbor Labs last year for basic cell/molecular research on prostate cancer.
And if you see men wearing blue shirts, when the men are wearing the blue shirts, then you know these are the guys who are going to help you. We're going to take a two-minute video right now. So let's take a look at this video before we close, and this can highlight what we're going to see.
Round, round, get around, I get around,
yeah,
get around, round, round, I get around,
I get around.
Where the kids are hip. My buddies and me, you're getting real well known. Yeah, the bad guys know us and they leave us alone.
I get around.
It's never been beat, and we've never missed yet with the girls we meet. None of the guys go steady, cause it wouldn't be right to leave your best girl home on a Saturday night.
I get around.
I know you have one more thing that you want to say, so.
Yes, the only thing the whole message that we've been trying to get across for 8 years, don't be afraid. Go and get tested. It's a simple, easy test, and it sure beats what the alternative will be if you don't get tested. That's my message to to every man out there.
That's our show today. Please take the help that's being offered to you. You are not alone. We're all here for you. We can all do this together. And thank you so much. See you next week. Okay.